I'm Nicholas Hoare for Vermont PBS. In 2022, the British Broadcasting Corporation will be 100 years old. Preparations are already underway for that stellar occasion. It'll last for a full year, and it will be something very special. But in the meantime, there are two books that I would like to talk about concerning its earlier era. One is called The Envy of the World, 50 years of the BBC Third Programme and Radio 3. And the other one is called Auntie's War, Auntie being the nickname for the BBC, The BBC During the Second World War by Edward Stourton. The book by Humphrey Carpenter, which we're starting with, is the story of the evolution of the BBC Third Programme. And for those who are not seasoned in these matters, BBC One, BBC Two, BBC Three, and BBC Four are the contemporary terms for the programmes involved. But in the old days, the third programme was the complement to the BBC Home Service and the BBC Light programme, and there were just the three. When this third, superficially posh leg to the station came on, it was regarded with a certain amount of scepticism, but it soon became clear that it was the peerless station of the lot. It had drama, it had theater of all forms, in fact, it had music, it had dance, it had you name it. This was the program devoted to culture in all its forms, hugely successful. In 1977, it changed its name in turn to the third program, and that's what it's called today. Humphrey Carpenter, writing as an insider, was asked by the BBC to write a history of the first 50 years of this remarkable program. And that is the book I'm holding. This was published 20 years ago. 20 years later, we have another aspect of the BBC, which is, of course, the Second World War. This one written by another insider who had, in his heyday, several programs, and still does, in fact, on the BBC, which he chairs. And his story is, again, a very interesting view of an extraordinary period of the BBC's history, where many a program was peppershot with thinly veiled propaganda, which would send coded messages to the forces in continental Europe, which featured, shall we say, high degrees of spy intelligence and was extraordinarily cleverly phrased. I'd like to read one particular bit in this book because it concerns the other side of the BBC, which was their direct involvement with the United States. And it concerns, in this case, the story of Edwin R. Murrow. Edward R. Murrow's first encounter with Auntie was somewhat discouraging. As a young radio executive working for CBS, he picked up the significance of a small item in the Chicago Daily News to the effect that one Mrs. E.A. Simpson had filed for divorce against a Mr. Simpson in the small Suffolk town of Ipswich, which is basically where I lived. This was the first published hint of the love affair between Wallace Simpson and Edward VIII, which was to cost Edward his throne. The relationship was well enough known among the European elite, but the story was notoriously suppressed in the British press and by the BBC. In the mid-30s, CBS, like the BBC in its early years, devoted very few resources to news. But Murrow argued strongly that a story of such magnitude would bring in listeners. He managed to convince the network bosses, but because all broadcasting from Britain went through Broadcasting House, he also had to persuade a reluctant BBC, and the corporation had played a central role in covering up the story. One of his colleagues recalled that, quote, "We were on a bit of a sticky wicket. The BBC was very uncooperative. They didn't control the wires, but we had to use their facilities. At first, they refused. Sir John Reith was still at the helm and thoroughly disapproved of the whole abdication episode. He thought it, quote, awful that all this crisis was caused by a miserable second-rate American woman." But once the story became public, in early December 36, even the BBC had to go with the flow. However, on 11th of December, he even authorized the interruption of a program sponsored by Heinz of baked beans fame to bring the audience the news that the king had given up his throne for, quote, the woman I love. The episode persuaded Murrow's ratings-hungry bosses in the U.S. that there was money in news, but it also demonstrated the strength of the rival network, NBC. It was NBC who was able to call upon the services of a British-born reporter who consistently managed to get to the studio and broadcast over the one circuit available a quarter of an hour before CBS got its bookings. This young man's name was Alastair Cooke, and he would later become something of a national institution on his own with his weekly Letter from America on Radio 4. As you can see, that was one page of text, and there's over 400 of other ones. Fascinating stuff, absolutely riveting, and I think, anyway, a real example of potted history at its best. And on that newsy note, good evening.